I've got four people to cover today, and I'm not reading mine. I'm going to just sort of ad-lib it as I go. I've got some notes here with me. A couple of things I might mention, first of all, since we all speak English and we all like English history, I should tell you that in the 16th century, which we call the Reformation century, Spain was far and away the superpower. France was right behind. England was a distant third. So divorce from your minds any idea that we're talking about one of the powerful nations. Really, England was way behind Spain and France, and it came to politics in the 16th century. England had been under control of two different houses or dynasties. You know, the word house means dynasty. I always think of what God said he was going to raise up, a sure house. Most of my students know what a house means, but if you know English history, you know that a house means a dynasty. And for 100 years, it had been the House of Lancaster, and the House of York had been slugging it out. And in 1485, Richard III lost in the Battle of Bosworth, and the crown fell under the mulberry tree, and Henry VII, a Tudor, picked it up and put it on and said, "I am the king." That was the only claim he had to the crown, and that was not a very strong claim, and that haunted him and his heirs all the way to the end of the Tudors. They didn't have a strong claim to the crown, so they were really nervous about hanging on to it. Now, the Reformation, really, I'm going to be looking at the Tudor Reformation today. It starts with Henry VII in 1485. At least the Tudors start there. And the Tudors end with Elizabeth I in 1603, when James came down from Scotland, a cousin, to become the new king. And I tell my church history students, the problem with the Tudors, there weren't enough of them. There were only a few, and there were certainly not enough men to be on the throne, and that was a big problem. So here we have this small country, and Henry VII has two boys in his family, and the oldest son who would have inherited the throne was a fellow named Arthur. So he looks around for a wife for Arthur. He could have sent him to Hope Sound Bible College, but he didn't. He looks around for what we call a diplomatic or a dynastic marriage. And so he goes to the largest country at that time, which is Spain, and he finds Catherine of Aragon. And the Spanish agree, and so Catherine of Aragon, as a girl of about 15, comes to England with millions of dollars in money called the dowry. And so England can use that kind of money. So she comes and marries this boy by the name of Arthur. Arthur only lives for 4 years, 4 months after the marriage, and he died. What to do? Well, Henry VII doesn't want to see all that money and her go back to Spain, so they work out a deal for her to stay and marry the kid brother. Now, if you know your Bibles, you know this is called a levy rate marriage. My students think that levy rate, L-E-V-I-R-A-T-E, has something to do with Levites. It doesn't. The word lever is a Latin word which means brother-in-law. This is the duty of a brother-in-law, and we have examples of that in the Old Testament. If a man dies without a son, without an heir, without somebody to keep his name going, then the next son is to marry the widow and raise up a son unto the departed older brother. Well, this is going to be tricky. Rome is involved. This is a kid brother. The book of Leviticus says that you can't marry a sister-in-law like that, so what to do? So the Pope grants a dispensation, and they agree to let Catherine marry this young chap by the name of Henry, who's going to become Henry VIII in England. I take time to mention that because that marriage is going to become an issue later on. Henry is an interesting fellow. He's a man filled with a great sense of his own worth. He's proud. He's arrogant. He speaks several languages. He plays a nice lute. He's very urbane and a gentleman. He understands what it takes to be successful in that day. He's hale, hearty, and well met. He will brook no opposition. If you disagree with him once he is crowned king, it doesn't take much for you to be convicted of treason. If you're found guilty of treason just by disagreeing with him, you get a one-way ticket to the Tower of London. You won't need a two-way ticket because you're not coming back. So a lot of people die under the charge of treason. In fact, when we talk about Bloody Mary, that daughter who takes over after a while. And we read in Fox's Book of Martyrs about how many people she martyred. Truth be told, if you did a head count, her father probably killed more people than she did. But because Fox's Book of Martyrs was so sensationalized these things, she comes across as Bloody Mary, Mary Tudor. Well, there is daughter born to this relationship between Henry and Catherine, and her name is Mary. Now, the thing about this, I sat there sort of wistfully listening to Mr. Snyder and those yesterday talking about all the wonderful theology and how God was moving in the church and all this. And when we come to England, you really got to look hard to see any of that. What you see is a lot of political goings on here. A man who's desperate to hang on to the throne, hand it over to a son, not a daughter. And so we get involved in what is known as the King's Great Matter. Bishop Stubbs in the Anglican Church said this about Henry: as far as the king, Henry was the king, the whole king, and nothing but the king. And later on, when it comes to this Church of England that he's going to invent, he wants to be the Pope, the whole Pope, and something more than the Pope. So Bishop Stubbs has an interesting way of describing him. Henry is a full-blooded Catholic through and through. In 1521, Dr. Jones mentioned yesterday, he wrote a book or a tract called In Defense of the Seven Sacraments. And the Pope was so impressed with it that he conferred upon him the title The Defender of the Faith. So relationship is real good between the Pope and Henry at this point. By the way, for those of you who aren't students of church history and you don't know that much about Catholicism, there are seven sacraments in the Catholic Church. We Protestants only have two. We do communion and baptism. They've got seven sacraments. And you basically judge how Catholic a man is by how many sacraments he subscribes to. If he's a seven sacrament man, then he's Catholic all the way. And I mention that because once Henry starts getting threatened politically by France, he's going to start waffling and he's going to start jettisoning some of the sacraments. He'll have Parliament to pass some bills and reduce it down to six and five. I think he gets down as far as four sacraments. When France is threatening to invade, they cut it down to four sacraments. And then as soon as the heat is off and he realizes there won't be an invasion, he goes back to seven sacraments. So sacraments are like a thermometer. Just watch and see how many of them they're holding on to, and you can tell how Catholic they are at any given moment. Now, this king, powerful, arrogant, proud, one who will brook no opposition, is concerned by 1525 about not having a male heir. He's concerned because he's got a weak claim to the throne, and he knows any outside challenges would be very difficult for him to defend. So in 1509, he is crowned as king. Catherine is made the queen, and they do it on the basis of the levy rate marriage. By 1525 now, all he has is this daughter who would be a queen. There's only ever been one queen in English history at this point. Way back in the 11th century, a Queen Matilda, and without going into that, let's say that was not a very successful tenure. Henry knows that, and he certainly doesn't want that kind of history repeated again, not on his watch anyhow. So somehow, he's got to find a way to get a wife, a queen, who can produce for him a son. And in Parliament, in the halls of Parliament, this becomes known as the King's Great Matter. It starts in 1525. There's a lot of chatter and talk behind the closed doors for a couple of years. And finally, Henry decides he's got to find a way to get some, either get a divorce, get an annulment, hopefully charges of adultery, but that's not going to work. And so he rounds up his papal legate, a fellow by the name of Cardinal Wolsey, a very corrupt man, a man who's fabulously wealthy. If you get any kind of income from the church, you have what's called a beneficed position. Now, you know that term because today when you get a job, you ask, what are the benefits? Benefice is any kind of income. Usually it's income in kind. There wasn't that much cash circulating in the offering plate. It may be in beef, it might be in vegetables, fruit, whatever. Of course, there is some money involved. But any position in the church that earns you a living is to be envied. You have a beneficed position. The higher you go up in the church, the more money you make. There's more tithes coming in. A bishop gets a skim off of each one of the local parishes. You got the curates and the rectors and the rector and so forth, and these various ones who are preaching on the local level. A cut of that goes to the bishop. Then the bishop, he has all these preachers, and a cut of his goes to the archbishop. And then some of that goes to the cardinals, and then a scum off the top goes to Rome, where the pope is living a life of luxury. One of the popes, I forget which one now, it might have been Innocent III, when he was made pope, he said, "The papacy is ours, let us enjoy it." Wow, what an attitude for the top man in the church, right? So this money that goes to Rome is known as an annate. If you're appointed a bishop, for example, your whole year's first year income goes to Rome. There's always ways to get money skimmed off and sent on to Rome. So by 1527, Henry pulls in Cardinal Wolsey. By the way, having a beneficent position, he had three bishoprics. He's fabulously wealthy. Fat fellow, I've seen a picture of him, great big gold chain he wears around with his little crucifix. Fabulously wealthy, just sucking the people dry with money. And Henry is a good friend, he's a good friend of Henry. Henry says, "Look, I want you to go to Rome, get me out of this marriage one way or another. Get an annulment for somehow, do whatever you can." Now the problem is, when Wolsey gets to Rome, the problem is the Holy Roman Emperor is the nephew of the woman that Henry's trying to dump. So this is going to make problems. The Pope knows this. The Pope is already under a threat from the Holy Roman Emperor, Charles V at that time. So basically what the Pope says is, "Let's just stall. Let's just buy time. Maybe the old girl will die. Maybe she'll have a son. Who knows? Let's just stall. Tell Henry we're researching this thing, and we'll get the theologians on it, and maybe some miracle will happen." Well, you can tell Henry anything you want, but just don't stall with Henry. He'll only put up with that nonsense so long. And then he starts looking around and sending emissaries out, searching around among even some of the Lutheran theologians to see on what basis he might get out of this marriage. Well, finally, Wolsey heads back to England to tell Henry the bad news. Henry has already sent the word out to arrest him for treason by the time he gets back, and mercifully, Wolsey died of natural causes before Henry could send him to the Tower. In the meantime, he finds this fellow by the name of Cranmer. Cranmer is the man of the moment. Cranmer has got Reformation blood in him. Luther's ideas have been surfacing in England. We've talked a lot about the Bibles. In Cambridge, William, you guys have been to Cambridge, you can tell me where the White Horse Tavern is, where they used to go upstairs in a secret room, read Luther's writings, and talk about what's going on in Geneva, the various reformers over in Europe. And so these English ideas, as all the way back to Wycliffe, are surfacing. The Hutterites, followers of John Huss, they're well aware of that in theological circles, and Cranmer is in this thing all the way. So finally he decides that the only thing left to do is hopefully the Archbishop of Canterbury, which is the most important ecclesiastical post in England, it's not in downtown London, it's way out on the east end out by the North Sea. That's the oldest bishopric, and whoever's Archbishop of Canterbury runs the church in England. And so Cranmer is just waiting for an opportunity for old Warwick, the archbishop out there, to die. In the meantime, Henry starts taking matters into his own hands. In 1531, when Parliament meets every year, there's the House of Commons and there's the House of Lords. While the House of Commons is meeting, Henry goes down the street to the House of Lords, where all these bishops are, and these are all the moneyed people. And he walks in and he charges them all with premunire. Now, premunire is a Latin word. It basically carries the idea of you taking orders from somebody outside the country. It's an old statute. It's been on the books since back in the 13th century. Henry digs this thing up, goes in, and he says, "You're all guilty of premunire. I can send you all to the Tower." But he said, "Reasonable fellow that I am, I'll let you live. All I'm going to do is fine you 116,000 pounds sterling." Well, what would you do if it was either the Tower or put up some of your money? Henry never has enough money, and very astutely, they take up the deal, and this is called the submission of the clergy. He puts this tremendous fine on them, and they agree to basically come at his beck and call. So now he's got the clergy in his hip pocket. Now in 1532, Henry takes the next step. He appoints Cranmer as Archbishop of Canterbury. Mercifully, the old Archbishop Warwick has died, and so now he's got his man in the most powerful place in the realm. That same year, he goes to Parliament and cajoles them into passing a bill known as the Act in Restraint of Annates. Henry says no more money is leaving the realm to go to Rome. And so, sorry about that, Pope, you're not getting any more money out of England. Then in 1533, Cranmer then annuls Henry's marriage to Catherine of Aragon. She is sent off to a palace with her little princess daughter, Mary. And of course, she's as Catholic as the Pope is, and so is Mary. So keep that in mind when Mary gets back on the throne. She's going to be Catholic through and through. As soon as he passes the Act in Restraint of Annates, then later on that year, he passes the Act in Restraint of Appeals. Now, this says that if anybody in the realm tries to appeal anything to anybody outside the realm, it's going to be treason. This specifically is done by Parliament at Henry's behest so Catherine doesn't appeal to the Pope to try to undo what's happened to her. So the marriage has been annulled. Henry has done this on the basis that he should have been following Leviticus instead of Deuteronomy. Okay, he says, the problem was this levy rate marriage and God's anger with me, and that's why my wife can't have any boys for me. So being a religious fellow on that point, he follows through. And in January of that year, 1533, he does a secret marriage with Anne Boleyn. As Dr. Jones said, he was casting his eyes about the court. Always a problem when kings have too much time on their hands. And so he sees this young thing that he would like to have for his wife. And so he marries her secretly. Stupidest thing a man can do. Don't ever do a secret marriage. I've actually heard of a couple of Bible school students who thought they could get married secretly and maybe go public in the summer. Don't do it. If children come along, you got a lot of explaining to do, so just forget it. But here, Henry thought he could pull it off. So he does the secret marriage. And now he's got... he's got a wife, he's got an archbishop that sees things his way. Now his wife is expecting, and Henry is just happy. I mean, God's in his heaven and all is well on earth. He's got a pregnant wife now who's going to be due in September, and Henry walks around. Late in August, he buys the cigars and goes down to the waiting room, waiting for this promised son to come along, and Henry had one thing he couldn't manipulate, though, and that was the gender of this child. She's another girl. This is Elizabeth. Oh, Henry is outraged. All the machinations he's gone through has netted him a grand total of nothing. He's right back. Now he's got two daughters, and he still needs a son. Not to worry. Henry's always got a plan. In 1534, he takes the next step. This is the most important act probably in all of English history. 1534. It's on every test I give to my students. This is the year in what he does, it's called the Act of Supremacy. Parliament passes it, basically spells out this new church. It had been the church in England, and he's going to change one preposition. Now it's going to become the Church of England. All the difference in the world in those two letters. It was just a church in Germany and a church in Spain and a church in England, but now this is the Church of England. And basically it says that the king is the head of this Church of England. 1536, he has Parliament pass the 10 Articles. In this, he reduces the 7 sacraments. I guess he went all the way down to 3. I couldn't remember. He's worried about France. France is threatening to invade. Want to get him back, get the English back into the realm for the Pope. He did keep baptism and penance. And the Mass. Then he drops confirmation, drops marriage, drops holy orders, and drops extreme unction. As I said, Henry never has enough money, so in 1536, he starts moving against the monasteries. Do you know when finally all the monasteries were closed in England, there were almost 1,000 of them. I mean, it's hard to get down a road in England without coming to the ruins of a monastery. They were everywhere. And as Mr. Snyder said, in Europe, the church controlled a third of all the real estate, most of it through the acreage that went with these monasteries. So the church is fabulously wealthy, and they own you for 1,000 years. They baptize you as an infant. They confirm you. They serve you your first communion. They listen to your confession. They marry you. They give you last rites. They bury you. It's got to be in a dedicated cemetery, and they'll pray you through purgatory. I mean, they control all the rites of passages. The church owns you. And if the king doesn't play ball with Rome, when one person gets in trouble, they excommunicate you. That means you can't take communion. You don't want to get in that position if you're a Catholic. But if the Pope is mad at the king, he will place the whole country under the interdict, which basically temporarily excommunicates the whole nation. And when you've got a peasant population that's superstitious, they believe anything the priest tells them, and they find out on Sunday morning he can't serve communion, or on Tuesday night he can't hear confession, why? Well, there's a problem between London and Rome. And the little guy says, well, he better get it straightened out. We want to get things up and running again. So this interdict is a powerful weapon, and we have several cases in church history where Rome used this against various kings. Well, finally, the next thing is to get some kind of a charge against Anne Boleyn. She was very Protestant in her thinking. She was very much into Reformed theology. But Henry's got to get rid of her, so he trumps up charges of adultery. No basis in fact for it. I'm sure she was a godly woman. I've read the accounts of how they took her out, had a big platform built, whole crowds around, children are there, day off school, everybody's going to watch, the queen's going to be beheaded. And they finally lead her out onto this platform. There's the chopping block. She kneels down in front of it. A priest stands in front of her with a crucifix, and a Frenchman with a sharp sword whacks her head off, and the head rolls almost to the edge of the stage. Ghastly stuff it was. But he's got rid of another wife now. He's looking for a third wife. Next, somebody finds for him Jane Seymour. Jane Seymour is another Protestant woman, a good woman. She did one thing right that none of the other women can do. She bore him a son. Unfortunately, when Edward VI was born, due to childbirth complications, she never left the childbirth bed. She died within a week or two after he was born. Well, Henry's feeling more pressure again from France, and so he decides it's time to cozy up to Germany and the Lutherans. And so he sees a painting, or probably Cromwell brings him a painting. Mr. Snyder mentioned Holbein. Holbein was the great painter of the day, and somebody presents him with a painting of Anne of Cleves, a German woman, very much a Protestant. And Henry falls in love with her painting. Now, the problem with paintings is you can touch them up, you know. You can airbrush them or whatever. And Henry is all excited. This is just the woman he needs. He's happy. He's got a son now. Edward VI is thriving. And he just needs a woman around the place. And this thing drags on forever. It starts early in June, and it's like August till she finally arrives. She's got this huge retinue of servants and people traveling with her. They cross the channel. They take this big pontoon up the Thames River. And finally, this hot August night, Henry is just prancing around this great hall waiting to meet this lovely woman. And finally, they lead her into the big reception hall that night where he's going to see his lovely creature for the first time. And she's nothing but a plain Jane. And Henry is just crestfallen. He took Cromwell aside, and here's his words. He said, "She pleaseth me not well." It wasn't long after that that Cromwell got a one-way ticket to the Tower. Now, we're not sure what the causation was there, but Henry only lives with this woman for about 4 months. Mercifully for her, she didn't bear any children, and he gets Cranmer to do his magic, and she's sent packing. Then he finally marries a young Catholic thing by the name of Catherine Howard, a dashing young lady who got found in bed with the wrong guy. This time the charge stuck. She gets a one-way trip to the Tower. And then there's one other woman that he marries, Catherine Parr. a woman who is about as old as he is, kind of a plain lady. But at this time, Henry is 400 pounds. They had to build a derrick to hoist him onto his horse. Pity the poor animal that had to carry him around London while he was showing off as king. And she had the singular fortune of outliving the old goat. So Henry then dies 1 year after Martin Luther. Martin Luther died in 1546, and just a few months later, Henry is on his deathbed. Now, it's a treasonable offense to project the death of, you don't talk that the king is dying, but everybody knew he was, nobody would say it. The Privy Council is summoned to this huge bedroom. Here's Henry propped up on his big bed, and Holbein paints this deathbed portrait. Cranmer is on his knees beside the bed, holding Henry's hand while Henry is confessing. And as my old professor, Dr. Beer, said, heavens knows Henry had a lot to confess. And in 1547, Henry died. Now, things pass on now to this young boy king, 9 years old, Edward VI. So do you understand now what we call the Henrician Reformation really changed nothing at all. By the time Henry dies, the realm is as Catholic as it ever was. He's as Catholic as he ever was. They're back to seven sacraments. They're still only doing communion in one kind. You understand the laity never drank the cup. They only got the bread. Preachers could not marry. It was still celibacy of the clergy. And really nothing much had changed. It's just now called the Anglican Church or the Church in England. Now, Edward, at 9 years old, nobody thinks he's old enough to reign. He's a very bright young man. I think precocious would be a word Mr. Snyder would use. And he reigns sort of in behalf of the Duke of Somerset and one of the other, Duke of Northumberland. They take turns sort of as vice regents, and they sort of counsel him, and they're all very pro-Protestant. So under the reign of Edward VI, Protestant Reformation now happens in England. Things really move forward now with Henry out of the way. Edward VI is a very sickly boy, probably has tuberculosis or something. He's going to only live to the age of 15. What happens is Archbishop Cranmer kicks into gear now, and he develops the first Book of Common Prayer. The Book of Common Prayer, the BCP, the first one comes out in 1549. And in it, he organizes the Church of England along the lines that we have today. Whatever else Cranmer was, he was a great liturgist. Do you know when you marry someone today, most of what the preacher says is stuff that Cranmer wrote? And in the main, when you do a communion service, most of the words that we use were words that Cranmer wrote. They've been modified a little bit, as I'll talk about in a few minutes. Under Cranmer, they remove all restrictions to the Bibles now. Anybody can have a Bible. They used English now instead of Latin in the church services. All the chantries were dissolved. You know what a chantry is? If you were a person of any means, if you had a big castle out of town, you probably had a little private chapel in there, about the size of what you'd see in a hospital. You've gone to a hospital chapel, just a nice little room, a couple of pews in there, maybe a little communion table or something. Very typical for those days, only they would, if you had that kind of money, you would hire a priest. You would endow him, you would set aside some money, and that money would pay. You would have your own little private priest, kind of like what you have back in the Book of Judges. If you remember Brother Mitchell's sermon last year on Messed Up Mama, you remember in the boy he preached on, he had his own little private Levite? Well, that's what a chantry is. And the idea was he prayed for you and your family while you were alive, but more importantly, when you died, he prayed you through purgatory. Okay, Edward VI says no more of that. No more chantries, no more endowed private priests. Purgatory was outlawed. Masses for the dead were outlawed. And now we come to the doctrine of the real presence. When we talk about the doctrine of real presence, the issue is, for 1,000 years, it's been transubstantiation. As early as 831, a fellow by the name of Radbertus wrote a book called On the Body and the Blood of the Lord. Retramnus followed him a few years later. These guys are setting in motion the idea that when the priest elevates the host, the cup and the bread, they turn into the body and blood of the Lord. We talked about that somewhat yesterday. Thomas Aquinas in the 12th century, using a lot of Aristotelian philosophy and logic, argues how this happens. He talks about accidents. versus, what's the other word, accidents and properties. What's the word I want, Bill? Help me out. Okay, well, the idea is, we'll say this is a cup of water. So I say abracadabra over, and it changes into something else, okay? Its basic characteristics didn't change, but its essence, that's it. Its essence remains the same, but its accidents change, okay? So it's still wet like water, looks like water, but it's something different, because I said so. And Thomas Aquinas, who is the theologian of the Catholic Church, develops all this in his Summa Theologica. It's four or five volumes. You can read it if that kind of thing interests you, to prove how this happens. And as Mr. Jones said yesterday, they ring a little bell when this happens, so you know exactly when that moment of transubstantiation takes place. Luther says, no, it's consubstantiation. Somehow Christ is with, by, and under the elements, but it really doesn't turn into that. And later on we'll notice then, I'll save that, but there's some other thoughts. So right now, in his Book of Common Prayer, when the priest prays over the elements and then he's ready to serve it to the people, notice what he says in the words there. He said, take, eat, this is my body. Hoc est corpus meum. Remember he talked about the hocus pocus yesterday? Hoc est corpus meum. That's Latin for this is my body. And so Cranmer leaves that in the prayer book because Henry's changing a few things and Edward's changing a lot of things doesn't mean the guy in the street went along with this. So to keep from outraging all the Catholics in the realm, Cranmer kind of eases it in. So he says, all right, we're going to do communion, but we're still going to say, this is my body. All right? So all the Catholics in the realm, they're okay with that. Then 2 years go by, and so in 1553, Cranmer decides to move it up a notch, and so he issues a revised Book of Common Prayer. Now in this, he abolishes the Mass. There is no more Mass. There is no more sacrifice of Christ. The communion table, which once was an altar, then it became a communion. You hear the word commune, where we're all in common around the table. The communion table becomes the Lord's board. Now, what is the Lord's board? Well, I tell my college students this, you pay tuition and then you pay room and board. It simply just means the cafeteria, it's the food. So the Lord's board is the communion table. When we come around communion, we partake of the meal that recognizes Christ. So the communion table becomes the Lord's table. And now, when the priest dispenses the elements of the communion, here's what he says. Listen closely and think what your preacher says. He says, take and eat this in remembrance that Christ died for thee. Well, what happened to this is my body? Now, this comes out of Zurich now. This is Zwinglian. This is a memorial meal. We're just doing this in memory of Christ. Certainly no transubstantiation here. Don't think of this as the body of Christ anymore or the blood of Christ. We're just doing this in remembrance. The Catholics are outraged. It actually led to a rising. A group of Catholic princes in the north part of England got an army together and marched all the way to the gates of London before it dissolved away. This did not go over well. Now the cup is given to the laity. So the next time you take communion, just remember for 1,000 years, you wouldn't have gotten the cup. You'd have only got the bread. You weren't good enough for the cup. Only the priests had that. And so... That's the 1552 Book of Common Prayer. In 1552, a creed put together, the 42 Articles of Faith of the Church of England. Basically, I'll summarize, it was Lutheran in that it taught justification by faith. It was Calvinistic in that it taught predestination. So you'll see that coming together now in the theology of the Church of England. A year later, at the age of 15, Edward VI passed away. Died of what historians then called consumption. As I said, it's probably a form of tuberculosis. And I'm always interested in people's final words. I have a little volume on my shelf at home called Dying Testimonies of Saved and Unsaved. I think a fellow by the name of Shaw put that together. I bought that years ago. It's kind of morbid, but it's interesting what people do say in their last sentences as they leave this world. And in that book, half of them are wonderful. You know, Lord God, receive me. You know, I see heaven, I see angels. Others are not so good. Some of them saying, half the realm for a moment of time. People talk about feeling the fires of hell. Edward seemed to be probably a saved individual, to use our language, but he was not a happy person. And his last words were these, "Lord God, deliver me out of this miserable existence." Not a happy king of England. Well, as soon as he dies, guess who comes on the throne now? His half-sister, Mary Tudor, is brought out of the palace where she's been holed up with her mother, with her Catholic priests and Catholic friends. Immediately, Cranmer is put out of business as the Archbishop of Canterbury. Cardinal Pole takes over the church. She forces Parliament to run the clock back to 1547 so that everything that happened under Edward was erased. Just like Trump was trying to undo everything Obama did, they tried to undo everything that Edward had done, but it didn't work. It's too late. The horse is already out of the barn. But 800 clergy refused to take an oath of loyalty to the Queen and to the Pope. 800 clergy just lose their parishes, fled to the mainland. 300 were martyred almost within a matter of months. Some of you are familiar with the famous martyrdom of Latimer and Ridley, the two who were tied at the stakes, good, godly men. And one looks, couldn't look over his shoulder, but over his shoulder he says, "Play the man today," he said. "We shall by God's grace light a fire in heaven, or in England, such as shall never be put out, or light a light that shall never be put out." And these men burned to death. I just can't imagine. You know, you go to a barbecue and, wow, it's hot. Can you imagine them making a pile of wood at your feet and lighting that thing up and just roast you to death? And then there was Cranmer himself. Cranmer, a little bit of a disappointment. He ended up okay. They call in Cranmer and say, "We want you to undo all this stuff." And he says, "I can't do it." And so they threaten him with a death, going to send him to the Tower. And he decides to recant. So they write up a recantation. And he agrees to take back everything he had done heretofore. And then his conscience bothers him, and then he asks for a pencil or paper and pen, and he writes a recantation of his recantation. And then he gets scared, and he recants again of that one. And about the fourth time around, he's recanting everything he can think of, and finally the church said, "We don't care." They take him to St. Mary's in Oxford, got him up in the elevated pulpit, and they assumed that one last time he would take back everything he had done and somehow ask the Pope to forgive him. Instead, he gets up in there and he really does play the man. He just calls the Pope an Antichrist, calls fire down on the whole ecclesiastical system. They yank him out of the pulpit. And they take him out into Oxford, into the square of town, where he is tied at the stake. And his famous lines were, he said, "This hand hath offended most." This is the one that was signing the recantations. "So it ought to burn first." So somehow he manages to get that hand into the fire ahead of the rest of his body. I just can't imagine all this. But Cranmer died then. Well, Mary Tudor is a very unhappy woman. She rules just under 5 years total. In the year 1554, she marries the King of Spain, Philip II. And Philip II comes to England, spends about 2 weeks with her, and she never sees him again. The whole thing was just sort of a political arrangement to try to get England cemented into Rome good and tight again. And it's during this time that John Fox writes the Fox's Book of Martyrs. What's it called? The Martyrs and Memorials, something like that. What's the proper name for that, Ben? Acts and Monuments. That's it. Thank you. And as I said, he's been writing this thing for some time. He goes clear back and starts the Spanish Inquisition, but he really kicks into gear during the Marian persecution of the church. And what is amazing, while she's trying to stamp out Protestantism in England, these men who resign their parishes and they go to Geneva or they go to Frankfurt, Germany, or different places, all they do is drink deeply of the Reformation over there and the Reformed theology. And so when she's finally done and Elizabeth takes over, they come back more Protestant than they ever were. So she thought she was going to end what was going on in England by doing that. She shot herself in the foot because these men come back on fire to continue the Reformation. Now, the strong man in Europe who should have come to England, he played his hand wrong. After Mary died, the last Tudor to come on the throne is Elizabeth. The Englishmen love Elizabeth, the Virgin Queen. She's going to rule all the way from 1558 clear down to 1603. And she's kind of the standard by which all other kings and queens are measured. We talk about her beginning, her ascension to the throne, as the Elizabethan settlement. She realizes she's got a mixed bag of people under her. She's got a lot of wealthy Catholics lurking around out there. She's got all these new exiles coming back, just brimming full of Reformation ideas and Calvinism and so forth, Reformed theology. So in 1559, she ascends the throne, and Parliament passes an act of supremacy for her. Very astutely, she will not allow them to call her the head of the Church of England. She calls herself the Supreme Governor, and the people love that. It's a step of humility on her part. And then notice in the Act of Uniformity what she does, she takes the best of both worlds. She takes the Book of Common Prayer of 1549, which said, for example, "This is my body," and she has them merge the 1552 prayer book with it. "As oft as you do this in remembrance that Christ died for thee." And so she blends the two together. Now you pay attention the next time you go to a communion service, or you preachers, you pay attention the next time you serve communion. We had communion a few weeks ago, and my pastor, the church is fairly large, the Salem church had about 275 that night, it was pretty full. So we took communion kneeling in our pews, and my pastor comes back and he starts the line down, the hands the tray to me, and he said, "Take this in remembrance." No, he said, I know what he said. He said, "This represents the body of the Lord." So I caught him at the door later and said, "You're a Zwinglian." Okay. What do you say? I'll tell you what you don't say, okay? Please, please don't say, "This juice represents the body of the Lord." This juice. Just leave juice out of it, okay? If you're going to say that, why don't you say "this Welch's juice," or you could say this great value juice, or give the content of it, give the breakdown of carbs and sugar. Well, why do you do that? You don't do that. Don't tell people what's in there. If they're worried if it's wine, they can ask you ahead of time. Just take it and don't ask questions. My old medical doctor was a Lutheran. He said, if you'd come over to my church, you could have the real thing, like I was being denied something. And I've told my students, just say "this cup." Just call it the cup and let them worry about what's in it. Please don't go down the line. I helped serve communion one day with a fellow, and all I heard was juice, juice, juice. As far as I'm concerned, he took half the sanctity out of the process. He's so worried about lest somebody think there's wine. We don't use wine. Don't worry about it. Just call it the cup. Let it just be a metaphor for whatever's in there. Now, she did require vestments on the clergy. She allows them to use one robe. She retained crucifixes in the churches. And an excellent way to get people to come to church, she fined all recusants 1 shilling. Do you know what a recusant is? Some of my bright students can figure it out. I had a lawyer from Cleveland one time, he figured it out. Have you ever heard about a judge who says, "Well, this case is going to come before me, but I can't hear this case because I know some of the parties, I have a vested interest in it," and so he recuses himself. A recusant is somebody who doesn't go to church when they're supposed to. So now you preachers have a new name for your absentees. Just call them recusants. And go ahead and charge them a few bucks, and you can build the next addition on the fellowship hall or whatever. She fined them 1 shilling for not coming to church. The 42 articles of faith were cut down to 39 articles. One thing was springing up in the realm under her was something called prophesying. Preachers were getting together and discussing the Word of God in private discussions. And that bothered her. Her first Archbishop of Canterbury, Matthew Parker, that you had mentioned, Matthew Park, had passed away. So she appoints a very godly man by the name of Edmund Grindal. And she sends a letter to Edmund Grindle, and she says, I want you to shut down these prophesyings. In other words, she's obsessed with all England worshiping the same way. No matter where you go to church on Sunday morning, she wants every priest reading out of the same book of prayer. Everybody knows what scripture lesson is going to be. Everybody knows how to do a marriage. Everybody knows how to do communion. Uniformity is the big thing with her. She doesn't care what you believe, just worship correctly. So everybody's doing it the same way. And there's nothing in this Book of Common Prayer about prophesying. So she tells Grindle to get rid of it. I don't care how you do it, just get rid of it. And he sends her a letter, and he says, O Queen, live forever. And basically he says, why don't you let me run the church and you run the realm? Wow. Now what she did, she so was enamored with Grindle, she didn't fire him, she didn't send him to the tower, she just sequestered him for the rest of his life. He continues to earn a living and dies of natural causes at old age, and Whitgift comes on as the next Archbishop of Canterbury, a man who takes it upon himself to deal with the last problem that confronted Elizabeth, and that was Puritans. All over England, there were these people who said, O Queen, live forever. You've done a wonderful thing. We really like the way the Church of England is moving here. We just haven't gone far enough. There's a whole lot more ground to cover here, and we need to be doing this. We need to be eliminating this. We don't need communion every Sunday and this and this and this. And they start agitating to purify the church. And Whitgift despises Puritans. And so number one in his job description is shut down the Puritans or get rid of them. Puritans are going to hang around and haunt her the rest of her tenure, all the way and then under the Stuarts, when James gets on the throne in 1603, and Charles all the way down after the English Civil War. Finally, Oliver Cromwell, Mr. Puritan himself, becomes the Lord Protector of the realm until they restore the monarchy in 1660. Well, I'm not sure what time I started, Paul, and I'm not sure what time I should quit, so I'm going to do it right now. I'm done.